know that it's always a good thing to give blessing instead of cursing. We're going to sing that verse again. This time I want you to stand with me. And I'd like you to go find them all. And as we sing this, there you go. Some of you are sitting right next to one. Look them straight in the eye and say,
the Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you.
Bow down before.
the Lord. He has given us a song and a soul. Oh, he's worthy, worthy of all our praise. Oh, yes, he's worthy, worthy of all our praise. Cries to you, worshiping in spirit and truth. Glory to the faithful one, Jesus Christ our Lord. You are God.
Be glad in it. Amen. Now you do have a choice. You can grumble, you can complain, you can do all those other things, but I encourage you to be like Joshua and say, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I'm leaving.
my past behind. I'm setting my heart and mind on you, Jesus. I'm reaching my hands to yours, believing there's so much more. Knowing that all you have in store for me is good, it's good. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Well, I don't worry about tomorrow, trusting in what you say. Today is the day. Putting my fears aside, I'm leaving my doubts behind. Heart of grace to you, Jesus. Putting my hands to yours, believing there's so much more, and knowing that all you have in store for me is good, is good. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, I won't worry about tomorrow. I'm giving you my fears and sorrows. Where you lead me, I will follow, trusting in what you say. Today is the day. Oh, today is the day.
Hallelujah, I'm coming with a heart of worship. I'm bringing in a brand new song. I'm ready to see the unthinkable. I'm ready for a miracle. Let's pray for a fresh encounter. Souls open to a living God.
Like a
Hallelujah. 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 Spirit of God, fall on us. Fall on us. Oh, breath of God, breathe on us. Breathe on us. Spirit of God, fall on us. Fall on us. Oh, breath of God, breathe on us. Breathe on us.
Sing it with me.
Spirit of God, fall on us. Breathe on us. Your presence, your power, alive in us.
This is our hope, Lord, today.
Your glory descending, oh, your power.
Forever our God, you're more than enough.
God, you're more than enough.
Forever,
forever, our God, you're more than enough.
Oh, forever,
our God, you're more than enough. You are amazing.
And nothing comes close to Almighty, nothing as sweet as His love and mercy. Nothing comes close to Almighty, nothing so sweet as His love and mercy. It was He, and nothing comes close. Such an awesome God, so mighty, so holy, so wonderful. Such an awesome God, so selfless, so generous, so faithful you are. Such an awesome God, so an awesome God, so selfish, so generous, so faithful you are. You are amazing, more than amazing. Jesus, thank you. Where two or three are gathered in your name, you're right there. Thank you, Lord, that you have allowed us to experience what it means to have the living God inhabit our praise. And Lord, I pray now as we turn to opening your word, I pray that, Lord, our eyes will be open to see wonderful things from your law. And that, Lord, it will cause us to grow in grace and knowledge of who you are. Lead us, I pray. Guide us. Direct our hearts. Direct our minds. Bless the words spoken. Let it become life, spirit to our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated.
Well, this morning to have my mama here. She's known me all my life and loves me anyway. I'm also very thankful to have four of my children here today, two of which call me mama, and the other two call me bonus mama. So I'm very thankful for that. I have figured that over the last 25 years here at Cornerstone that I have spoken probably 18 Mother's Days. A in each Mother's Day message that I have spoken, I have tried to acknowledge the fact that while it's a special day for some to celebrate, there are many who do not look forward to this day. I am very much aware that as I can call Mother's Day special, not everyone receives this day with joy. Some moms will visit a graveside today. Some women face excruciating pain of empty arms for yet another year. Some moms will find themselves wondering if what their kids said in their Mother's Day card is really true, because they just see themselves as failures full of regret. Today there will be hopeful mamas watching the road for their prodigal, or at least listening for a text. Some folks will choose to forget this day altogether and a childhood at the hands of an abusive mother, whether it be physical or emotional. And some will find themselves missing their moms that have passed away. And for some, it will be the first year without their mama. But wherever you may find yourself this morning, Jesus knows exactly where you are, and he longs to be invited into your day. As I prepared for this today, I thought, maybe this isn't as much of a message as it is a testimony, a part of my personal road down the mother road of motherhood, a road that's been almost 37 years in the paving. That's when you all were supposed to say, oh my word, Kristen, you don't look like you could have a daughter 37 years old. Well, I don't believe you. Yeah, you guys missed that big time. Yeah, 37 years in the paving, a road that has had its shares of hurts, disappointments, struggles, as well as much joy. And a road that finds me in a very different place in my mothering this morning. So whether you decide this word for today is a mother's personal testimony or you find it as a message, I hope that it encourages you in some way. Since Resurrection Sunday, we have been on a personal journey with the disciples to Pentecost. And some may ask, why is that important? Why is the journey to Pentecost important? Why does it matter what happened between the resurrection and the explosive day that God poured out his Spirit? Well, it matters because the journey matters. The details of our journey matters. And what happens while we are waiting for the promises of God matter. And this is very evident in the journey of a mom. When you are expecting a baby, you wait and you anticipate the birth. 9 months is a long time to wait, but during that 9 months that you're waiting, you're preparing. You don't just come home from the hospital and then prepare. You don't decide to get married, want a beautiful church wedding, show up to the church and expect that wedding. There's preparation. You can't show up to high school or college graduation without completing what is required. You had to walk the road to completion. And this can be said about many of the important events in our lives. They not only take preparation, but this road we walk to get there can be equally important. This journey that the disciples took into the upper room was equally important. This journey in raising children to become adults who love Jesus is equally important. The day of Pentecost wasn't the end of the journey for the disciples, just like a mother's journey doesn't end when her children move out. And I believe with all of my heart this morning that as mothers, we have to know that we know that we know that even though we can't see Jesus in physical form, standing in front of us while we change diapers, wipe little noses, watch our children leave for school, and eventually leave home, he wants to be in that journey. Whether that journey is just starting out and you find yourself in an empty nest trying to figure out your new role as a mom, he is walking with us through it all and is willing and wanting to step into every occasion, just like he did with the disciples, and say, peace, my peace I give to you. You've heard it said, and you might even have said it yourself, you are such a mom. It's often said with a negative tone, like we are meddling. When I asked one of my children way back when, if I had a superpower, what would my superpower they responded, nagging. To which I reply, I do not nag, I constantly remind. Is that what you're such a mom means? Constantly meddling, always hovering like a helicopter? What does it mean, you're such a mom? Maybe you've seen the Mother's Day cards that say God couldn't be everywhere, so he created mothers. That is not true. However, I do believe that God created something extraordinary in the heart of a mother. He could have chosen any avenue to bring his son into this world, yet he chose a woman, a mother. And it was said of Mary several times, she treasured these things in her heart, these things that were concerning her son. So I don't think that we should view "you're such a mom" as an unfavorable saying. I believe what makes us "you're such a mom" is what a mom has treasured in her heart, things that only God will know. Well, you saw some examples of great mothers in the Bible. Let me point out that none of these moms were perfect. But what a perfect God did in and through them, that was extraordinary. Sarah was the mother who waited. Hagar was the mother that endured. Rebecca was the mother who believed. Leah and Rachel, the mothers who had to share. Jochebed, the mother with a plan. Hannah, the mother who kept her promise. Elizabeth, the mother who believed in miracles. Mary, the mother who is blessed among women. There's one thing that these mothers have in common, as well as every mother in this room and any mother that may be listening. It isn't that we have the same amount of kids, how we love our kids, or our style of parenting. The one thing that we have in common, the one thing that we will have to face, no matter how hard we try to fight it, the one thing we will all deal with is at some point, we will all have to let go of our children. Letting go doesn't start the day they walk, the day they go to kindergarten, the day they drive, day to move out or get married. The letting go process starts the day they are born. And we may not think of it that way, unless you're like me, of course. I remember Michael was just a few days old, but I remember like it was 30 years ago yesterday. Looking at this precious son being so overwhelmed with love and bursting into tears, knowing that someday another woman will hold his heart. And that thought crushed me. And then the day I realized that that other woman had come into his life and his heart was hers, I'm sure I burst into tears again. You're such a mom. But I just want to say on a side note, I couldn't have handpicked my bonus children any better than what they did. So if someone else has to hold my son's heart, I am very thankful it's Marissa. And that's not something probably most normal people think of. But the letting go process has started from birth. And with each milestone, we let go just a little bit more. The first giggle, the first tooth, learning to crawl, learning to walk, going to school. Oh, there's another area I burst into tears. From preschool to college, every first day of school, I bawled like a baby, individually for all of them. You're such a mom. Our hearts grow a little bit bigger with each of these milestones, but at the same time, they can break because we know the day will come that we have to let go. You've heard it said, blink and your children will be grown. This is very true. I've even stopped moms in the store with little children, and I've encouraged them, enjoy the journey, because every bit of it, even the rough times, because it goes fast. And now that I'm on the other side of babies, toddlers, and school-aged children, I can most definitely say it really does go by fast. I have blinked and they are all grown. As a "you're such a mom" mom, We have expectations and hopes for our children, and this is in no way a bad thing. We look forward to all of those firsts, the first word, the first tooth, the first steps. And as they grow older, our expectations change. We become hopeful that the teenage years will be over quickly. We look forward to graduations. We look forward to their brains being fully developed. Careers, successes, marriages, grandkids. And in all of those expectations, we are letting go. Letting go of what we want to be had. And in those events, things don't always turn out for the best. Sometimes it's not even about the turning out for the best, but it's about they don't turn out the way we think they should turn out, the way we hoped they would turn out. One of the greatest struggles as a mom, and I think it's safe to say not just moms, but anybody who has relationships, is that of expectations and letting go of those personal expectations and allowing God to work out his plans for those we love, even when it's painful for them and for us. An expectation is the act or state of looking forward to or anticipating. Summed up in one word, it's hope. And who doesn't have hope for their children? Who doesn't want the best for their children? If you think about it, on an average, parents invest about 20 years, give or take a few years, in raising their children, caring for them, teaching them everything from how to walk to how to drive. The love for a child has been described as a fierce and unbreakable love. It's been said making the decision to have a child is momentous. It is to decide forever to have your heart go walking around outside of your body. Raising children can be the most rewarding and difficult endeavor we can ever undertake. It's no wonder then that when it's time to let go, to let our children go out on their own, and actually I'm not even talking about out on their own, I'm talking about making their own decisions and choices and mistakes, it's a struggle because we are so invested. So whether we find letting go easy or difficult, we can do so by recognizing that children, our children, are in God's loving and able hands. We need to remind ourselves that these kids do not belong to us, and they never did. Psalms 24:1 says, "The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. The world and all its people belong to him." We don't own our children, but our responsibility to them is great. Deuteronomy 6:5-7 says, "And you must love the Lord with all of God with all of your heart, all of your soul, and all of your strength. And you must commit yourself wholeheartedly to these commands that I am giving you today. Repeat them again and again to your children. Talk about them when you're at home and when you're on the road and when you're going to bed and when you are getting up." Our hope cannot be in our children to make every perfect choice and never experience a painful consequence. Our hope can't be that our children will never fail, disappoint us, or break our hearts. Our trust can't be that they will always choose what is right and never go to the left. Our hope and trust has to be in Jesus. Somewhere in this process of letting go of our greatest treasure, we have to believe with everything that is in us that he and only he is trustworthy to hold in his hands what we value most precious. It's hard to fathom as parents, as moms, that anyone could love our children more than we do, but Jesus does. Not only does he love them more than we could ever, he has numbered their days, and he has seen them all. He was the one that knit them together in the womb. How can we not trust him? My go-to parenting verse has been 2 Timothy 1:12. "I know in whom I trust, and I am sure that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him until the day of his return." If you have entrusted your children to Jesus, he's got this. And so, Lord, where do I put my hope? My only hope is in you, Psalm 39:7. Hebrews 6:9 says, when we place our hope in Jesus alone, he is a strong and trustworthy anchor for our soul. The key difference between hope and trust is their base. Trust is based on reliability, confidence, or belief in someone else. In our case, Jesus. That's where we place our confidence. Whereas hope is not based on such qualities. Hope is a desire and an expectation for a particular thing to happen. We as parents should be putting our hope in knowing that we can trust Jesus to keep his promises. One of the most popular verses in the Bible is Proverbs 3:5-6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him and he will make your path straight. The Message Bible puts it like this. Trust God from the bottom of your heart. Don't try to figure out everything on your own. Listen for God's voice in everything you do, everywhere you go. He is the one who will keep you on track. No matter what translation you look at or how it reads, the message is the same. Trust the Lord with everything and in everything with all of your heart. Don't try to figure it out according to your limited understanding and knowledge. Put him first, and he will keep you on the right path, the path of righteousness. Every day brings new opportunities to trust him in our own lives as well as the lives of our children. I can't look at Proverbs 3:5-6 without thinking about Romans 8:28. And we know that all things God works for the good of those who love him and who have been called according to his purpose. God works good for the good in all of the things that happen to us if we love him. But not all things are good. Some things are bad. He's still working. Some things are hard. He's still working. Some things are wonderful. He's still working. Some things are just not fair. He's still working. Sometimes our hearts are broken. He's still working for our good. I don't always have to see it, and I won't always understand it, but I believe it. And then that's when we have to go back to trust the Lord with all your heart. Don't get caught up in what we don't understand. Acknowledge him in all we do, and he will make a way. We have to trust his perspective. Why? Because he knows and he sees the facts. He is truth always. He sees the puzzle pieces of our lives, and in the end results, they all come together. He sees all the pieces of our lives and in our children's lives. Philippians 1:6, be confident of this, that he who's begun a good work in you will carry it to completion. That's another really good verse to hang on to for parents. He is not going to lose the pieces to anyone's puzzle of their life. But our perspective is often clouded by our own ideas, feelings, and what's going on around us. So we don't lean on our own perspective. Trust God's. Letting go of our children is a process, a long process that starts from birth. And we have to have something greater than ourselves to hold on to during this process. Because I can promise you there will be times of parenting that you just don't understand, but we can trust that God does. We would eliminate a lot of frustration in our lives if we would stop trying to figure out God and simply believe with all of our hearts that he is trustworthy in all areas of our lives, especially our children. Proverbs 22:6 says, train up a child in the way he should go. Even when he is old, he will not depart from it. What a seemingly simple but overwhelmingly complicated verse. It's one of the most quoted and probably misquoted verses in the Bible. People often use this verse as a guarantee that if you raise your children in the discipline and instruction of the Lord, they will always stay on the right path. Well, that interpretation can be problematic, particularly for those good parents we know who have seen their older children stray from the faith. I think we all know we can try our best, and sometimes the results are different than what we would have hoped for. God has given us all a free will to make our own choices. And that right there is another really hard thing for a mom to walk through, watching our children walk away from Jesus. Most of you are very familiar with the story of the prodigal son. I'm going to read some of it, not all of it this morning, just to familiarize yourself with it. Luke 15:11. He said, there was a man who had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of property that is coming to me. And he divided his property between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into the far country. Notice the father lets him go. And there he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose across the country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into the fields to feed the pigs. And he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate. And no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I perish here with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants. And he arose and he came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced and kissed him. And the father said to him, and the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring quickly the best robe and put it on him, and put the ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they begin to celebrate. This parable is about us and our Heavenly Father. And no matter how far we have strayed, his arms are open with everlasting love and forgiveness, just waiting for us to return. It has, however, also been the source of much peace, hope, and comfort to those parents whose children have left the faith, those who have walked away from a godly inheritance. And I have pondered this story a lot lately, and I have wondered, where's the mom? Now, obviously, this story is not an actual account, but rather a description about how heaven rejoices when the lost are found. But if she was there, how torn that mother must have felt between the practical wisdom of her husband and a mother's need to try to understand where her son was coming from. I imagine she would have had flashbacks of a dirty-faced little boy standing in the doorway with a fistful of flowers, thinking, when did he grow up? He wasn't a bad boy. He's just immature, caught up in the desires of this world. And I'm sure she would have felt her heart splitting down the middle. She was helpless to stop what was happening to her family. I think I have an idea why the prodigal parable doesn't include a mother. A mom would have tried to talk him out of it. She wouldn't have stood there and watched her son walk down the road. She would have ran down that road after him. She probably would have bribed him to come home. It has been said that moms are a little bit better at enabling, trying to fix things, and I don't think that's a compliment. And someone probably said to her, you're such a mom. maybe moms have a bit harder time letting go. And we certainly can have a harder time watching our children pay the consequences for bad decisions, even going as far as trying to prevent them from those consequences instead of trusting that God is bigger than their wrong choices. It can be easy to get in the way of what Jesus is doing in the lives of our children because of our own emotions. There is not a mom here today, I don't think, that would want to see their child in a pig pen starving, or would we? The greatest need our children have in this world is Jesus. And if our children are going to return to the Father because of a pig pen, then that's where we want them. And as harsh as that may sound, and as hard as it may be to watch, the ultimate goal for every parent who loves Jesus with all of their heart, mind, and soul is for their children to do the same. And that is the heart of God as well. We mustn't forget that just before the parable of the prodigal son, Jesus tells the parable of the lost sheep. He leaves the 99 to rescue the one. He loves that much. I am thankful for the pig pens in my life. I'm not sure I was thankful at the time. But in those down and out and dark and dirty places, that's where we often hear the voice of the Father saying, "Come home. You were lost. Now you're found." Isaiah 55:8 said, "My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine." He can use a pig pen to bring our children home. Ephesians 3:20 tells us that he is able to do far more abundantly all that we could ask or think. Letting go is one of the worst ingredients of parenting and one of the most necessary and important and inevitable. With letting go comes a temptation to worry. What if they make stupid choices? What if they can't keep safe if I'm not there to protect them? What if they can't pay their bills? What if someone breaks their heart? What if they eat a dozen cupcakes for breakfast? What if they date someone I don't like? What if they drive too fast? What if they don't remember everything that's been spiritually planted? What if they don't call me? What if they end up in a pig pen? God is not the God of what ifs. And he tells us in Philippians 4:6, don't worry about anything, even your kids. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Our children will make mistakes, and we will love them through just as God has loved us through. We are told not to worry. We are to pray, ask, and be thankful. The only way that we can genuinely let go is to recognize Jesus is holding on. He's holding on to us, and he's holding on to our children. We will have to let go in different ways and at different times throughout their lives. Sometimes we have to let go in small ways. Sometimes the letting go is done in life-changing ways. But each of these times, we must hold on to Jesus. Isaiah 26:3 promises, "You, God, will keep in perfect peace all who trust in you, all whose thoughts are fixed on you." There are times the choice of letting go is made for us by a death, and there are no words for the death of a child. Letting go when your oldest daughter and her husband moved to the othermost parts of the world, otherwise known as Northern Michigan. It's hard, yet there's a confidence when you know that your children are walking in the will of God. Letting go because your children are starting a new life with a godly mate, that's one of the times where we rejoice and gladly let go. I might need a drink. letting go because of the decision that they make to squander their godly inheritance breaks your heart. But we let go and we hold on to Jesus, remembering that he is close to the brokenhearted and he sees these tears. So we don't worry. We pray. We ask and be thankful, and we keep our eyes on him, trusting him. This is not really a flowery Mother's Day message or testimony with a cute little acrostic for mom. It's not filled with 10 easy steps to receive the Mother of the Year award. But this is where I am personally today. I am such a mom. I am the mom of two married children, of which I'm required to share and letting go. I am the mom that blinked and her baby became an adult, making decisions and choices that are hers to make, letting go. And I am the mom of a prodigal. My heart is broken and is letting go and choosing to hold on to Jesus. But I don't believe for a minute here that I am the only one in these situations this morning, that I am the only one brokenhearted by decisions made by those you love the most, that I am the only one learning and sometimes battling to let go, to hold with an open hand these gifts that God has entrusted me with, and yet trusting him, endeavoring to trust him with all my heart, leaning on him and not my own understanding. I know there are such moms here today. So the next time someone says to you, "You're such a mom," rejoice. Because in those four words lies the heart of God. Loving, forgiving, nurturing, compassionate, kind, gentle, and always waiting for us to return home.
This week I was praying about how to end this service, and I just wanted to bless moms. And yet I realized that the nature of this message is one that has a big umbrella. And some of you moms are in a situation where you're navigating that holding on, letting go type thing. And I want to reinforce, you're not alone. So I'd like to invite you moms to come, stand shoulder to shoulder to each other, and we're going to pray for you. But I want you to stand next to somebody who's walking through some of that same challenge. And realize that as we come before the Lord, we come with the idea that I can trust him with everything and nothing less. The first line of this song says, "Humbly I stand an offering with open hands, Lord, I bring everything and nothing less." Today, as we sing this, I just want to again, come on, moms. Stand next to another mom.
Humbly I stand and offering with
Stand behind your mom, your wife. Stand behind a woman who's walking through those letting go things. And I'd also like to invite those who just maybe struggling with letting go, fully trusting, fully committed lives and hearts. Teach us, Lord. It is so sweet to trust in Jesus. Let it be more than just an old hymn. Let it be more than just, Lord, a Sunday sermon. Let it be our heart. As moms, as children, as Cornerstone,
I surrender all.
Here we are, Lord. We give it to you.
I surrender all.
Jesus, Teach us what it means to trust you more. And I pray for these moms, Lord, on this day we set aside to honor them, a special anointing of your presence, a special release, Lord, of faith. Let it increase. Let it be, Lord, a true blessing to have been in the house of the Lord, to have wept, laughed, lifted our voice, lifted our hands in praise and worship. Let us walk this week out, Lord, with a sense of your presence magnified. Inspire these moms, Lord. In a day where the idea of motherhood is being challenged on so many levels, raise up, Lord, these women of faith. Their faith, Lord, and the faith of the grandmas, Lord, be passed on. I pray, Lord, that there would be just a sense of increase. Increased energy, increased creativity, and increased passion, Lord, that the next generation might see a wonderful example of what it means to be a godly woman, godly mother, godly wife. Forgive us, Lord, when we've given in to the ideas and thoughts of this world. Cleanse our minds, purify us. Let us once again honor what you have done, establishing bless you, moms.
Yes.
And keep you. And make his face shine upon you. May this week he be gracious to you. And this week may you see his face looking at you and give you peace.